storytelling for those professionals that are in the social services to help us tell our story better for fundraising, for building community and social impact. So please help me welcome Michael Kass.
Hey everybody, stand up! This is going very well so far. This is great. Just want to do a brief exercise with you. I know it's early, so I thought we might do some yoga. No. Let's do this. For the next few minutes, I'm going to make some statements. If you agree with the statement, go ahead and stand. See where the sort of round border is, where the room divider would go? If you agree with the statement, that's where you go. If you are sort of like, I don't know, or I don't want anybody to know on the statement, hang out by the coffee. And if you completely disagree with the statement, hang out by the yogurt. Right? So yes, round border, maybe coffee. I have a feeling there's going to be a lot of maybes, and no is yogurt. I'd also invite us all to do this exercise in silence. And so there'll be some navigation. There's tables, there's obstacles, there's human beings. So silence, agree, maybe, disagree, questions before we start. Great. First statement, I am taller than 5'7". I was born after 1990. I believe that I can impact the future by the choices that I make today. Leader in my community. In my community. I listen to hip hop. I can change the world. I can envision a better future for all of us. So, what did you notice about that? We'll stay standing for a minute, and then we can sit. What did you notice about that exercise?
There's not very many tall people.
Not very many tall people. Right. So if I were to draw a conclusion from this data, it would be that End Abuse Long Beach attracts people who are mostly shorter than 5'7". Myself included. Right. Great. What else?
Optimism.
So there's, in the questions that were about the future, there was a fair bit of optimism. So it was all. I also noticed that we almost all of us can envision a brighter future. There's a larger number of us that maybe don't feel like we have as much of an impact on the future, right? So when we're talking about direct action, there were more people maybe. And then when we said, oh, well, in the abstract, I can envision it, almost everyone moved over here. Interesting, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I was surprised that so many people thought they could change the world.
Okay,
that surprised me.
Yeah. Was anybody else surprised by that? Yeah, it's a group of social workers. So, yeah. So what was anybody, did anybody, because there were a couple times where there was only one or two people in one of the sections. If you'd like to share, what was that like, either for the people who found themselves kind of outside the group or for the people who were in the majority? Yeah.
Made me feel super young.
Yeah, right on. There were, I think, two of you over there. Yeah.
Made me feel super old.
Super old. So we're in both extremes. Yeah.
It made me feel right.
Made you feel right. Yeah.
I was the only one that was right.
And everyone else was against you.
Yeah.
Made me feel out of the loop. Uh-huh. Like, and I'm cool that so many people listen to hip-hop because I didn't know that many people.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. We're learning about each other. This is great. Anything else that you noticed? So, if we're doing a workshop on storytelling, what relationship might this exercise have to that? Yeah.
To learn, if you learn something more about someone, you can tailor that story specifically to them.
Yeah, I actually hadn't thought of that, but I love that, right? Yeah. Anything else? Yeah.
We're all kind of making up stories, like, in this whole thing, because none of it's really true or not true. It's kind of like, I can make up a story if I have no impact on the world, or I have
right. Right. And I, as the facilitator, have just created a bunch of data points, and I can tell any story I want to using those data points. So one story I could tell is, most people who are 5'7 or shorter are optimistic about the world. Totally valid, based on the data that we have, right? And so when we start to think about storytelling, we realize how important it is for us to tell our stories, because we're leaving trails of data behind us all the time that we might not be aware of, and other people are putting it together. So if we don't put that data together for them, they'll do it, and they'll probably get it wrong, right? And so that's what we'll be investigating and exploring today in this workshop, is this idea of how can we empower ourselves to tell our stories, and if we work with clients or organizations, how do we help them tell their story more effectively, so that based on actual real data, so that the target audience, clients, others can interpret that data in the way that we want them to, as opposed to the way that their brain naturally tends to, which tends to be more negative than we would like. Please have a seat. Thank you for playing. I know it's early. Good job, everyone. Here is a brief story about how I sort of came to do or got really curious about storytelling as it relates to social impact. Before going full-time into story and storytelling, I worked in the nonprofit social impact sector for 20 years as a staff member, doing everything from grant writing to director development to program evaluation, and finally as a financial management consultant. I was everybody's worst nightmare, is that last one. And there was one moment in particular when I was director of development for a service center for homeless youth in Hollywood, called My Friend's Place, and part of my job was to give tours of the facility. And usually people were really polite, and they would call ahead and make an appointment and give me their name so I could Google them and find out all about them and figure out how to give the most effective tour possible for that person. One day, the doorbell rang, and I opened it, and there were two dudes there, like guy. They were probably like over 6 feet tall, so taller than most of us in this room. And they were construction guys, right? And I'm a little dude, and I was a little intimidated, and they wanted a tour, and I went, oh, okay. And I couldn't read them, so I did the only thing I sort of knew how to do, which was I took them through the facility. And in each room, I just told a story, right? So we had a parenting room, and in that room, I told stories of young people, specifically of a young man who had been grappling with drug addiction and found out he was going to be a dad, and in that moment decided to kick the addiction because he didn't want to be the kind of father that he had had, right? We had a circus room because we offered circus arts to the youth, which was an amazing program. And in that room, there was a high wire that wasn't very high. It was really a tightrope that was about this far off the ground. And when young people wanted to walk across it, which of course they did, they needed to reach out for support, right? So they needed to have physical support. And for many of them, that was the first time they had experienced touch that supportive instead of threatening. So stories like this, in room after room, there's probably 12 rooms, and I'm trying to get a read on these guys, and I'm not getting anything from them. And we finish the tour, and I leave them in a room with a conference room, which is really just a small room with a folding table like this one. And I went to get them some coffee. And then when I came back, there were two $10,000 checks on the table. And all they said was, you tell really good stories. And then I got really curious as to what had just happened, right? What was it about the power of story that, without even asking, they had decided to contribute something which, to this organization, was a significant gift, right? And so what we're gonna do today is, in about an hour and 50 minutes, we're going to go over everything I've learned in the 10 years since that happened, and you will leave the room feeling empowered, and go team, you'll know everything I know. It's true. And what will make that easier is that simply by virtue of being human beings, you are all already expert storytellers. So my goal is less to teach you things that you don't know and more to remind us all of things that maybe we've forgotten. Great. Following on that theme of data doesn't mean much unless we tell a story, I just told you a story to introduce myself. You can't see it that well, but these are all data points from my life. And using just these, I could have told you any number of stories to introduce myself, right? When I were in a Jewish community center, sometimes I work with members in the Jewish community. I spoke at a rabbinical congress not too long ago. And to them, I told them how I was kicked out of Hebrew school and then became a Hebrew school teacher 30 years later, right? They were super interested in that. When I work with storytellers, I tell them stories about being a mom, winner, and a nationally recognized solo performer, right? So the idea here isn't that we craft the perfect story for ourselves or for our organization. It's that we become conscious that we are constantly telling stories and that that story is fluid depending on who we're talking to and what we want them to pay attention to, right? So here's how we're gonna go through this today. We're gonna start by just at the highest level redefining story for ourselves, because there's probably 40 people in this room. We'll probably get like 35 different definitions of story, and if we're gonna work with it, it seems useful to all get on the same page. Then we're gonna talk about how to build strong stories. We're gonna go through identifying the characteristics that all powerful stories share, and then we're gonna talk about the process of moving step by step so that you can build stories, and it's a replicable process that you can use over and over again. We will also talk about how to guide people and discover their stories. Then we'll have a question and answer, and then we'll have a wrap up. Is there anything you would like to add? Sound okay? Great. So we can talk about screenwriting too. Los Angeles. So defining story, so when you think about story, what is it? What is story?
Which volume do you want to pick?
What, which volume?
Yeah, which volume, you know, it's like so many stories.
Yeah, so what is not what you, but like if you were to define, yeah.
Something that has a beginning, middle, and end.
Great, so a story, great, is something that has a beginning, middle, and end. I can get on board with that, yeah. What else for defining story?
Meaning.
So it's meaning, it's not enough that it have a beginning, middle, and end. It's gotta be creating meaning out of something, right? Yeah, what else?
They're transforming.
So maybe that meaning is transformational in some way, right? So there's now there's even a deeper purpose to it. Yeah.
Creates imagery.
So, great, right? Stories incorporate and create imagery for the imagination for the purpose of making meaning and transformation in the beginning, middle, and end. What else? Yeah. Yeah, I love that, and I wanna build on that one. Because there's a guy named Michael Wesch, who's an associate professor at the University of Kansas, so he's very fancy. And when he was doing his PhD in cultural anthropology, he actually went to live with an uncontacted tribe in Papua New Guinea. And they didn't have technology. By technology, I mean they didn't have writing, and they didn't have names, and they didn't have fixed dwellings, right? Basically, their whole community revolved around story and the relationships that they had with each other. So on any given day, if I had a story relationship with you, my dwelling might be facing yours. But then the next day, maybe I have a stronger story relationship with you, I would get my hut and I would move it to face yours. So you could actually see a social network constantly evolving, exactly like you're saying. It's really cool. There was a key difference that Dr. Wesch noticed, which was in this village, storytelling didn't look like it does today. But right today, when we think of storytelling, we think of something like this, with one person standing in front of a bunch of people talking about something, right? Or the moth, or any of the podcasts, one to many. In this culture, what storytelling looked like was a bunch of people standing in a circle, essentially yelling at each other and fighting over the details of the world that they were co-creating in real time. So, for example, through this process, that camera, hello, wouldn't just be a camera, it would be the camera where the spirit of the presentation lived. And they would arrive at that through this negotiated, co-created story. And then suddenly their world would be much richer because the world around them was literally alive with stories. It was really beautiful. Now the other thing that Dr. Wesch found is that until people had a story about you, you had no identity. You couldn't participate in this process, right? And it's not that they were mean to him, he was just always outside the circle. One day, they had spent about an hour telling him about all of the different poisonous snakes in the area. And that night, at about 2 a.m, he woke up and he felt one actually slithering across his chest. And he took it, he was terrified, and he started whacking it on the ground to kill it. Which is right when a village elder came with a lantern to reveal that his arm had fallen asleep and he was actually trying to kill his own arm. So now they had a story about him. It wasn't the story he would have chosen at all, but he could participate. He became an entity in this culture. While he was living with this tribe, something really interesting happened. The government, with nothing but the most benevolent thoughts, wanted to vaccinate the children of this village. In order to do the vaccinations, they needed to take a census. In order to take the census, what's the first thing you need to take a census? You need names. So they introduced a new technology. It was called the census name. The other thing you need is addresses. And so they destroyed all of the dwellings and set up very neat huts that were fixed. And within about 6 months, that story-based culture was decimated. It didn't exist in the same way anymore. What I love about that is it shows that when we carve away all of the technology, what's left is story. It's the stories we tell ourselves, it's the stories we tell each other. And that's it. And so my definition of story, which incorporates everything that you all identified, is simply that it's the basic building block of community. So when we're talking about building a community, whether it's a community of supporters for our organization, a community of clients, a community within this room, what we're actually talking about is arranging ourselves around a shared narrative and a core mythology. And so if we take a second to think of all of the different communities that you're a part of, whether it's religious, being the team, a fan of a sports team, whether it's being an alumna of a certain university, at the core of each of those communities, there's a story, there's a mythology. And the reason you're a part of that is there's something within you that resonates strongly with that mythology. And going back to that idea of co-creation. The moment that we join a community, our story starts to interact with that core mythology, and that core mythology starts to act on us, so we're actually growing together, right? And when we leave a community, it's usually because we've gone out of sync with that core story in some way. Making sense so far? This is super, like, heady stuff. So let's talk about science and ground it a little bit. I will prove to you that our brains are wired for story, and here's how I'll do it. Take a look at these two lines. Person one says, "Where's John?" Person two says, "Well, I didn't want to say anything, but the baseball bat is missing, and I saw a blue Prius parked in front of Megan." So person one, "Where's John?" Person two, "Well, I didn't want to say anything, but the baseball bat is missing, and I saw a blue Prius parked in front of Megan's." Please turn to your neighbor, figure out what's going on. You have about 30 seconds. So, wrap up your conversation. What did you figure out? What's going on here? Anyone?
Somebody ripped off the bat.
All right, that's fair. I like that. What else? What other stories did you come up with?
John was driving the Prius.
John was driving the Prius. Okay, great. What else? What you got?
John is driving the Prius, and person two was trying to protect Megan, thinking that John had a bat and was going to Megan to attack her.
Yeah. Did anyone else have something like that? Like not the nicest story? Yeah, exactly. I was reading this going like, oh, I know exactly what's going to happen right now. Although, I will say, I heard you say, no, it was you. You said, they're just going to play baseball. Yeah. Who else came up with that? Like, they're going to play baseball. So this goes along with the idea that, so normally, what will happen when we do this is 99% of the room will come up with something fairly awful. And there'll be one person who goes like, they're going to play baseball. You guys are crazy. So that speaks to the optimism of this room, unless you're lying. Yeah.
Except I will say, I didn't want to say anything because it's suspicious.
Yeah. Right, it does. It does.
Without that, we might have gone to baseball.
Right. So there's a couple of things here. The biasing of my wording notwithstanding. There's a couple of things. The first is, the process you just engaged in is inherently irrational, meaning that there's nothing to say that those people are even talking to each other. And even if some of it, there's always, it's like, yeah, I got it, yeah, totally. And even before you got it, what your brain did first was you went, oh, there's a story. No, there's no story, he's tricking us, right? The first thing we do when we see two data points is we try to connect them. The other thing that happens is that we tend to do it with a negativity bias. And that's an evolutionary adaptation that is actually really, really useful, if you think about it. Way back in cave person times, there's two cave people, and there's a bush that's shaking. One cave person goes, oh, a shaking bush, that's fun, and they go investigate, and they get eaten by a tiger. And the other one goes, oh, a shaking bush, there's probably a tiger there, and runs away. This is the one that survived to pass on as genetic material. So we've all inherited this negativity bias from the cave people. It makes sense. When there were tigers chasing us, it made sense. Now it can be sort of troublesome. So again, going back to the idea that when we're not telling our stories, other people are doing it for us, and this tells us that they're probably getting it wrong. And they're probably going negative with it. There's another piece of research that's really powerful when it comes to the impact that stories and data have. A bunch of researchers got a group of parents who were very active in the anti-vaccine movement together and sat down with them one-on-one and for 45 minutes presented a ton of data that showed how safe and effective vaccines are, how important they are, not just for the safety of the child, but for the whole community, showed all of the data debunking anti-vaccine research. This is just what they did. Wherever you fall on this issue, doesn't matter right now. Then they sent the parents off on their way. And a month later, invited them back. They went, so, have you had your children vaccinated? What shifted for you? So just by a show of hands, how many of you think the parents were now more likely to have had their children vaccinated. Yeah. How many of you think there was no change? And how many of you think maybe it was now less likely that the parents have had their children vaccinated? So it's that last one. They were less likely. And the researchers were shocked by this. And they couldn't understand it. The parents said, well, I don't know why you're surprised. You showed us all of that great data supporting our point of view. And the researchers were really confused and showed them the data again. Now everybody was confused because the parents were confused too. And it ends up that what had happened is the parents' brains had flipped the data upside down to support their internal narrative. They had been telling themselves a story that not vaccinating their children was actually protecting their children, and therefore all of the data that came in had to support that core narrative. They flipped it upside down. It's called the anchoring effect, right? When something comes in, the first story that comes in creates an anchor. Everything that comes in after that arranges itself around the anchor. So if we try to convince people to change their mind or to support us or to trust us with data, unless they already agree with us, it won't work. It'll either bounce off or it'll confirm their story. The only way to change that is to insert a new story in there. Is your question?
No, I was going to say, I think isn't another issue the relationship to the person who's giving you the data?
Absolutely.
So if you don't have a relationship, because all that happens in a relationship, then you're less likely to shift.
Exactly. And one of the powerful things about story is that it builds relationship very quickly. Right? So if you think about Facebook, for example, and fake news, right, those stories, think about how impactful that is. It's not that anybody believed it necessarily. It's that it just, those stories get in there and they create an anchor that creates a bias, and everything that comes in afterwards has to deal with that story. Two more pieces of research. This gets to where we're headed next. There's a phenomenon called neural coupling. Have you all heard of this? I know that there's some social workers and therapists. So this is really cool. A researcher at Princeton in 2009 had one of his graduate students tell a story and hooked her up to an fMRI machine to measure her brain patterns. And as a control, he first had her read the phone book. And there's one part of your brain that lights up when you read the phone book. It's right up here. It's the prefrontal cortex. It's just straight rational. It's the part that just is for data, right? Then he had her tell a story about a disastrous prom date that she had had. And her brain lit up like fireworks, the whole thing. If you look at the scans, it's actually really cool. And then he had a bunch of other volunteers come in, hook them up to the fMRI machine, and had them listen and watch her tell the story while their brains were being scanned. It's called neural coupling. What do you think? What do you think the research found? Yeah.
Their brains lit up the same way first.
Within 30 seconds, their brains were synced up. And they found something that surprised them as well, which was that the listener's brains sometimes lit up microseconds before the storyteller's brain did. So what does that tell us? Anticipation, right? There's a predictable structure to these stories. And so if you are ever watching a movie, you're talking to someone, and they say something unexpected, and you sort of do one of those, your whole body chills, that's because your brain has to reset itself. It's gotten ahead of the story, and it needs to reset. So if we really want people to pay attention, if we really want to make an impact, probably introducing an element, an unexpected element of surprise into the story is not a bad idea, because their brain will recalibrate, right? Storytelling is mind control. This is where I will pause to say, story, this power of story is value agnostic. You can use it for evil, many people do. Please don't. Yeah?
Just an open-ended question.
Yeah.
Is it an fMRI like a PET scan?
Yeah.
Same, like, is the same thing?
I believe so. Yeah, is it? Who knows more things about medical equipment? Yeah, I'm not sure. It basically measures electrical activity in the brain.
Yeah.
So one more piece of research done not too far from here at the Claremont Colleges. Stories, turns out, trigger chemical and hormone releases. Triggers two of them. The first is cortisol, which is a stress hormone, right? So if you think of any Disney, but how do most Disney movies start? One of the first things that happens. Yeah, they kill a parent, usually a mother. It's super stressful, right? Cortisol is released into our bloodstream. Here's the thing about cortisol. It's actually really useful in small doses because it focuses our attention. It gets all the blood from our brain to our body. The original purpose was to allow us to run away very quickly from a bear or a tiger. In large doses, cortisol is less helpful. If it keeps being released into the bloodstream, it leads to depressed immune function, weight gain, depressed cognitive function. So a benevolent storyteller like Disney doesn't want cortisol to keep flooding through the bloodstream. So they'll shift something up, right? Like Bambi will meet Thumper or something like that. We go, aw. And in that moment, a second hormone is being released from the brain into the bloodstream called oxytocin. It's our empathy hormone. It's our happy fun hormone, right? We love oxytocin. It's also responsible for creating a sense of tribe. And here's where it gets really interesting for people in the social impact space. When people's bodies are flooded with oxytocin, they are 8 to 10 times more likely to respond positively to a call to action related to that story. So if we want people to attend an event, if we want people to really take action on our behalf, it's probably a good idea to have their bodies flooded with oxytocin before we make that ask. And story is one of the most powerful tools we have to accomplish that. Stories promote empathy. Okay, that was like 10 years of neuroscience in 5 minutes. Questions or thoughts? Great, okay. This all comes with a caveat. It only works with good stories, right? And telling good stories is getting harder and harder because we are saturated, surrounded by story in a way that we have never been in the history of people being on Earth. We've got Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and digital billboards and phones buzzing and video and all of it, meaning there's a lot of noise out there. So in order to cut through the noise to become signal, we have to get really good at telling powerful stories. So the next question, suspense, is what makes a strong story? I can tell you, but that's less fun for me. So if it's okay, I'd like to have you all figure it out with a quick exercise. Yes.
Oh, figure it out with an exercise.
Yes, with an exercise.
Quiet.
No, yeah. Hold it inside, and when it's the right time, it shall fly forth. Yeah, perfect. Yeah. So I'll invite you. That was awesome. I know. I'll invite you to just maybe sit up a little bit straighter, and if you want to, you can just close your eyes, and I'm going to ask you a few questions. We'll do a brief visualization. I'll keep an eye on your stuff and your coffee. So just take a couple of deep breaths. And take a moment to really feel your weight in the chair. Just taking the opportunity to get a little present in the room. Being very aware with each inhale that this is you inhaling. Very aware with each exhale that this is you exhaling. There's no way to mess up this exercise. And now just think about a time that you wanted something. And it might have been a year ago, might have been 10 years ago, 15 years ago. And you may have a few different images or memories coming up. So we'll narrow it in by really thinking about a time we've wanted something in a very, very deep way, and in the kind of way that maybe if we didn't get it, we would explode or implode. We really needed this. And when we want something this way, it's not necessarily about the thing itself. It's about what we believe it will do for us. So what do you believe that getting this thing or accomplishment or person, what did you believe it would do for you? How is it going to change your life? Now, normally, when we want something like this, in this way, we can't just reach out and get it. There's something standing in our way. There's an obstacle. So what is that obstacle for you? And really, give yourself the opportunity to truly explore this memory. Any tastes, smells, sound, the quality of the light that comes to you. Now you really want this thing, so this obstacle is not going to stop you. You, at some point, tried to overcome this obstacle. What was that moment for you? And then once you made that effort, one of two things happened. Either you got the thing, in which case, congratulations. Who are you in that moment of getting what you want? And did getting this thing do what you believed it would do for you? Did it change your life in the way you hoped it would? And the other thing that might have happened is maybe you didn't succeed. Maybe your quest was not successful. So who are you in that moment of not getting what you want? That moment of defeat. And did you give up or did you try again? And finally, at the end of all of this, the end of this quest, you learned something. The way you moved in the world changed. It might have just been in a small way, but what are you taking away from this journey? Maybe take another couple breaths. And when you're ready, you can open your eyes, and if you need to, take about 30 seconds to write down any notes from the story that just came to you. Part of this. Everyone go ahead and find a partner, preferably somebody you don't know that well. And we're going to share these. As I say that, I'm aware that for some of you, some of the stories that came up were kind of personal, and it might feel a little vulnerable to share it. You don't have to share that story. I would invite you to do it, especially if it scares you, because storytelling is hard and we're human and we can do this, right? With that in mind, for this part of the exercise, just be aware that this is a confidential space. Any stories shared in the room stay in the room, and we're going to jointly agree to listen to each other with a great deal of compassion. I'll explain the structure for it. So, everybody please find a partner. You have 30 seconds to share your story. So person one will have 2 minutes and 10 seconds to share your story. Person two, your job is simply to listen. With something like this, the tendency can be to jump in and say, oh, I wanted that thing too. See what happens if you resist the urge to do that and valiantly sit silently and simply receive the story. Cool? All right. Person one. Wait for it. Person one. Begin. Your story. And we're going to have 7 seconds of silence. Here we go. Person B, or two, because we're doing numbers. Person B, two, please share your story. Your partner with a hug, fist bump, or handshake. For a high five.
Thank you.
Good high five. All right. So what did you notice about that? What was it like, first on the telling side, what was it like to share that story with your partners? What did you notice? Yeah.
Like, I felt empathy for the person, uh-huh. But I felt happy.
Right. So you had a whole journey in there.
Yeah.
Cool.
Really emotional journey.
All right. What else did you notice? That's awesome. Yeah.
So as I listened to the story, I got a sense of how important it was. Mm-hmm. Also, I heard a lot of optimism, even though it may not have come out exactly the way you wanted. It was an opportunity for the person to turn what could have been a negative into a positive.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. So you're learning not just what happened in the story, but you're learning something pretty key about your partner, like how she reacts to things in the world.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's beautiful. Did you want to add?
I was just going to say that. Like,
yeah.
You learn about who that person is.
Exactly, at a pretty deep level, right? Yeah?
I
I had to catch myself wanting to respond to her. She told us to be silent. I wanted to speak back to her and tell her how I felt for her. And
yeah.
I had to remind myself to be quiet.
Yeah.
And vice versa for me, like when she was, you know, sharing her stuff, which was pretty personal, like I had to catch the tears for myself and wanting to respond as well.
Did anybody else have that challenge of like really wanting to respond? And some, yeah, right? But it's a human thing. And sometimes one of the most beautiful gifts we can give someone is just letting them have the spotlight to share their story. A lot of times, especially in conversation, and this is particularly with nonprofits, although you also see it with startups, we get so excited to share about our work, and it's so important to us that we cut people off. We're like looking for an opening, and then we go, oh yeah, I felt the same thing. And we're robbing ourselves of the chance to like hear the full story of someone. So I think that's really, really beautiful. Yeah. What else did you notice about telling or hearing these stories? Yeah.
For me, I think this is a story I've told many times, but I was catching myself tailoring it to a person because it's a person I have a professional relationship with versus a friend or family. So it was probably a little slightly different story than for her than it would have been for somebody else.
Right. So there's a sense of which we're like in real time tailoring these stories to the audience. Did anybody else find themselves doing that? Going like, oh, if this were like at a bar, I would tell it one way. But I'm in a morning meeting and we're all a little tired. Yeah, go here and then there.
Well, it's similar to that, but English is not my first language, sign language is.
Oh, wow.
And so I speak through my body a lot, and my mom's Italian, so that helps too. But I found myself able to actually verbalize it, but when it came to the punch of, you know, pivotal, trying to show what happened, I found myself just going into showing it visually as well.
Yeah.
So that just kind of happened.
That's amazing. I love that because it sort of speaks to the vocabulary of storytelling. We think it's about the words. I mean, what's the stat? Like 90% of communication is nonverbal, and for you, it's probably more, right? So the fact that you went into physical doesn't actually take anything away from the story. It may actually hit at a deeper level, right?
I was just gonna say, you tell the story also, not just based on who the listener is, but how much time you pass.
That's right.
Head, right? So that definitely impacted what you share.
Right. Yeah.
I haven't told this story in a long time. It was back, you know, when I was in junior high. So it was just very exciting for me to share the story, and it totally just took me back to that time. And so it was very neat to go back in time and relive that part of my childhood. But it was exciting. So I felt myself like wanting to say it really, really fast and getting to the good part. And then the good part again. And then I was just like,
It sounds like other people might have had a similar experience, right? So there's an interesting thing about our brain is in that it doesn't know the difference between something it's experiencing and something it's imagining or re-experiencing. And so when we tell these stories, if we're allowing ourselves to get into it the way you did, those will feel the emotions. They will very much be there in a very real way. Yeah. Other thoughts or observations?
I have one. It was so weird. Mine was so random. It was a thought that came up from, I didn't even think it was a thought. You know, it was like you said something that you wanted, and usually you think of things that are very, I don't know, emotionally connected, but mine was so random. It was very random. That's all I can say. I'm sort of surprised looking back at all these things that I've wanted in my life that I came up with that.
Yeah. Did you, as you... So, first of all, thank you for staying with it, even though you're like, this is weird.
Yeah.
As you were sharing the story, did it start to make a little more sense?
It did.
Okay.
It did.
Yeah. So that's it. So there's, with this exercise, that often happens. And there's never anything random. And there's this thing that happens when it goes from brain to being shared orally that we figure it out, right? The story will shift on us as it's witnessed, yeah.
I think I have a symbiotic relationship with the woman next to me, because we both had different stories, but it was all about high achieving in education.
Mm-hmm.
And what we didn't get, it turned out to be what we wanted in the first place.
Yeah.
And it was both this, in totally different ways, it was the same story.
Yeah, did anybody else find that? That there were, the stories were similar but not similar, right? Yeah, that's a, we're all psychic. I mean, essentially, right, there are certain universal things, but that's really cool that you notice that, right? That usually, and I've done this exercise with at-risk youth and police officers and people in the senior center and elementary school students, and like, they'll have the same experience, right? Where they're sharing a very personal story, and then afterwards they'll go like, oh, we're the same person, so weird. Just part of being human. Yeah. Any other thoughts on your experience of sharing and listening to the stories?
Just along the lines of the psychic touch up that you touched on, interesting that the story you shared is something I was thinking about driving here this morning. Which, I just, like when you said that, I was like, I don't think I'm psychic, but I just thought that was really interesting.
Yeah.
That symbiotically, like, I have to be driving and thinking about that thing to be sure.
Yeah.
If you thought it was something else, he would have said.
That's right, that's right. Yeah, okay. 2 centuries ago, we would have all been burned at the stake for being witches. Here, we're just telling stories. It's okay. Yeah. So based on your experience just now, hearing and telling these stories, what are the elements of a powerful story? If you think about what really resonated with you, how do we create powerful stories? Yeah.
Emotion.
Emotion. It's got to have emotion.
Sincerity.
I love it. What else?
It's got to be relatable.
Relatable. So there has to be something sort of at its core that's human. It's not just things that happen. There has to be a deep, universal human emotion or need underneath it. Yeah. What else?
Vulnerability.
Vulnerability. You want to talk any more about that or just throw the word out?
The more I just got sucked in and yeah. on, and I think that the brain waves were matching, and I'm sure I was ending up in the same way she was.
Yeah.
There.
It's cool, right? So what I love about that is we all now know the science of what was going on in your brain, and just physiologically, and that doesn't, it doesn't stop it from happening. So it just goes like, oh, that was a good story, I know, because now I'm feeling warm and gooey, so I know that there's oxytocin in my bloodstream. Cool, right? Doesn't diminish the effect at all. Did you want to jump in with the?
I had written all those down, so I agree with all those, but as well, what I had thought about in the beginning was the exercise that we did on having like the yes, the no, and the maybe. Mm-hmm. I did not go anywhere in the maybe. It was kind of easy for me to just go to the yes or the no, and that was something I was thinking about, like when telling stories, like I really want to hear the yes or the no. Like I don't want to hear the, well, I don't know, or maybe not. It's like the sincere, like truth, like this is what I believe, this is what we're doing, very, like yes.
Yeah, that's interesting. I've never heard, that's really, yeah. So, if I could riff on that for a second, right, I love that because it, as a storyteller, it's about clarity and communication. So if somebody's wishy-washy on what the story means to them, or that is an indicator to me that it might not be time for them to share that story. And you actually see that a lot if you go to nonprofit events, you hear a lot of stories that aren't like powerful in that way because they're not quite sure what they're trying to communicate or they're hedging. So I think that's a really, I mean, you may have just added a new thing for me. Like, yeah. Woo! That's a big deal. I've done this a lot, so it's good. Thank you. What else? Yeah.
As you're saying that, I'm thinking of people's narrative. Because we share about our sons, and now they're adults. So I tend to be very positive. So I remember my son once said, Mom, sometimes people aren't ready to hear so many positive things. And I looked at him like, what are you talking
That's
about?
That's impossible. Yeah.
So, you know, when we're telling a story, because I do get really passionate, I've had many people say, like, wow, you are really very, very positive. So I don't know if that's good or bad, but my son kind of put it in perspective. Not everyone's ready to be there with me.
Yeah.
So when I'm telling the story, now I'm kind of thinking, that brainwave, how do I learn to match my audience?
So we'll talk about that in a little bit, but there's a type of story called And I Know What You're Thinking Story, which is that. It allows you, because what'll happen, right, if you come in super positive and they are, they will immediately write you off, right? They won't be able to take it in. If, however, and I do this, right, if I do this kind of work in a super corporate setting where they're not used to talking about hormone releases and emotion and vulnerability, that's like, I don't want to go there. One of the first things I'll do is I'll just say, hey, let me tell you about my history as a financial management consultant, because I think I know where you're at right now, right? And as soon as you do that, they're receptive. They just want to know that you recognize that maybe they're not super receptive. And in that recognition, they become receptive, pretty much. The trick is knowing, like doing the work beforehand to know where your audience is, just like you did, going, oh, this is in a professional setting, so I need to calibrate the story. Sort of the, a similar process, right? Does that help?
Sort of yeah, it does. I mean, yeah. It's usually like with on my personal.
Yeah, same thing. Yeah, you can see it. I mean, you're probably pretty astute. Like, if you're going full bore positive and people are going like this, you're like, I see that I'm too much for you.
I'm just reading a book right now on this topic, mm-hmm. which is making me think of this, but part of this woman's point is that in our culture, we want the story told in a certain way that, in her opinion, moves past the messy middle of, like, I don't know what's going to happen, or I'm in doubt, or and that Americans particularly want it. Let's get that happy ending, and not so much of the suffering or pain or not sure, or, you know, the outcome.
So that gets to this idea of structure, and I'll talk about how I think, I'll just move to my structure slide, because I think that's a great thing to address. But time is, we've been going 13 minutes. Okay, y'all heard of the hero's journey? Joseph Campbell, 1949, he wrote a book called Hero with 1,000 Faces. Joseph Campbell was a mythologist, and he read myths and stories from all over the world, and he came up with something he called the monomyth. It's essentially the hero's journey. I'm going to go through it in a certain amount of detail, and before I do that, there's a caveat with it, which is this. Joseph Campbell was a white dude who was also a little bit of a white supremacist. It doesn't take away from the validity of his research, but it does mean that it's implicitly biased. And so he called it the monomyth. In fact, there are many other structures that we could derive from the exact same research. This is the one, just to build on what you were saying about the sort of Western perspective. This hero's journey shows up in everything from Star Wars to Disney movies to Pixar movies to the way that the 24-hour news cycle frames stories. So it's useful to pick apart a little bit. And to do that, let's use a Disney movie. I think I can still get away with this. Has everybody seen The Lion King? Great! Somebody's really excited about The Lion King. Okay. So the first thing that happens in any story is we meet our main character. So in The Lion King, who is our main character? Simba, perfect. And what does Simba want? Simba wants to be king. And we know Simba wants to be king because he sings about it in the first 10 minutes. In a Disney movie, they will always sing about what they want. Right? Ariel wants to be part of your world. Bambi doesn't sing, but right? So we know that Simba wants to be king, but Simba can't be king. What's standing in Simba's way? His dad. Right? His dad is king. But that's okay, because his dad is a good king, and everything is in stasis, right? So the first part of the hero's journey is we meet the hero, we find out what they want, we find out really what the challenge is, and then we're just in a state of equilibrium until there's a call to adventure. Something happens that sends Simba off on an adventure. What happens? His dad, it's a Disney movie, his dad gets killed, right? And he, racked with guilt because he's been led to believe that he is responsible for this, goes off into the wild, right? And now there's cortisol because there's been this antelope stampede and Simba's very sad and it's horrible, but it's Disney, not a French art film, so they have Simba meet Pumbaa and Timon, or Timon and Pumbaa, and it's all Hakuna Matata, and now oxytocin, that's so nice, so nice. So now this is in the story structure. It's called the middle, right? It's called the body of the story. Simba is overcoming some challenges. And then in The Lion King, there is a climax. There's a moment at which everything shifts for Simba. What is that moment in The Lion King?
When he realizes he didn't kill, he wasn't responsible.
Right, it's Rafiki in the, it's Mufasa in the stars, he's not responsible. This is also, by the way, the plot to Shakespeare's Henry V, right? In that there's a moment of coming of age for the hero, and then from that moment on, everything else is the falling action. Simba knows that, first of all, he gets the girl. Nala, thank you. Then goes back to battle evil King Scar, and at the end, order is restored. And you know that because it's the same shot as at the beginning of the movie, and then the whole thing is they sing about it. It's a circle of life. Great. So that is the most pure example of the hero's journey, right? There is a hero, there are challenges, something shifts, hero comes back, and then there's a circle of life. There's another way of looking at it, and that's that it's a literal circle, right? And to get at what you were saying, this part, so in Greek myth, the characters would literally go from the area of life, consciousness, and order into the underworld, into this world of chaos and death, disorder. In American culture in particular, we have a pretty low tolerance for this stuff. And here's what I'll say. The more committed you want people to be, the more connected you want them to be to what you're saying, the deeper you actually have to go into that messy stuff. Because that's where actually a lot of the power of these stories lies. So in nonprofit storytelling, there's a horrible tendency to tell stories that go like this. Mary wasn't doing well. Mary met our organization. Now Mary's fine. Give us money. Right? It's not a very good story. Maybe 10 years ago it would have worked. Now everybody's telling that. What can distinguish your story from all of the others is the Mary wasn't doing well, and maybe the story doesn't end on such a nice, clean note. Maybe it's okay to be in that confusion and chaos because, frankly, that's where most of us live our lives most of this time, right? We have moments of like, I get it, and then there's a lot of kind of uncertainty. Maybe it's just me, I don't know. Right, and so part of this is about building a tolerance in ourselves for exploring that uncertainty, and the more comfortable we are with it, then the more comfortable our audience will be with it. Because people are actually really hungry for that kind of vulnerability, they just maybe won't admit it. Has definitely been my experience, right? So that is story structure. There is, I have time to get into this a little bit. There is a shift that's happening, partially because of technology, partially because the hero's journey is played out. The hero's journey tends to focus on one person, and it tends to be a story, meaning one person tells it, another person listens. There is another model that's starting to emerge really powerfully that's a much more collective model of storytelling. And you see it even in pop culture, right? If you look at Marvel's The Avengers, you have six individual heroes' journeys, but really it's a story about a collective, all of whom are heroes coming together. And so in organizational storytelling, there actually becomes an opportunity not to share like the powerful founder story, which is always great. There's another opportunity to share a story about a team that's doing good things in the world, a story about a consortium of organizations that has come together, not just to have coffee and listen to a little bald dude speak, but to come up with, right, new ways of preventing domestic violence and abuse, right? Those are the stories that are really starting to cut through the noise because we're hungry for that kind of collective action and collective storytelling. Right. I was about to get political. I'm not going to. Great, moving on. Shoes. I bought a DSW shoe warehouse. They had three strikes, and like 10 minutes later, he's still telling you about the shoes. Very animated, but you don't care anymore because he sucked all the momentum out of the story. So especially when we only have 2 minutes, or if we're writing a letter, a sentence, to grab someone's attention, it becomes not how many details can we cram in, but what are the right details to share with people so that they can fill in the rest with their imagination, right? And the third one that you all keyed into is this idea of authenticity and vulnerability. A few things to say about this. It appeals to the universal humanity, and it's really important when we're doing this that the stories we tell match the actions we take in the world, right? Because when we're being vulnerable with people, when we're being real, we're earning their trust. The best way to betray that trust is to do something that's diametrically opposed to the story you're telling. So a very famous example of this from, I believe it was early 2000s or late 90s, Walmart did this whole thing about how important healthcare was to them and how they took care of their employees, and then they were firing everybody whose healthcare was too expensive, right? It was a huge PR disaster. More recently, United Airlines, right? Right? We care about our customers. Right? 900 million in stock losses in a day or something like that, right? Because of that. So there's another thing with authenticity that builds on what you were saying, which is authenticity and vulnerability are not the same as full disclosure. Meaning, you get to decide based on whom you're speaking to and your own comfort level, how real you want to get with folks, right? So some people say, well, if I'm telling the story, I have to tell the whole story, I have to tell all the emotions and all the messiness, and that leads to things like a job interview. I was doing once, somebody applying for a job, telling me all about their recent divorce. And I was like, I want to give you a hug, and also, I'm not going to hire you. That was an inappropriately close disclosure, right? So something always to consider when we're crafting stories is who are we speaking with, and how vulnerable do we want to be, so it still feels authentic and also is safe, given the relationship. Questions on that before we go through a patented four-part process to build these stories? Yeah, all right. Step one, generate raw material. So I'm curious, before I show you my ideas, how might you find like raw material for stories that you were going to share professionally or at your local dinner party? Yeah.
From daily life.
Uh-huh.
And from your surroundings.
I love that. Yeah. There's a misconception that these stories have to be somehow like dramatic or epic in scale.
They don't have to.
They don't at all. Some of the most powerful stories I've ever heard just come from small moments of interaction. Yeah.
Exactly.
Where else? Yeah.
For me, something that has some kind of emotional pull for me so that I can get behind it and tell it.
Exactly. Because if we don't care, nobody else will care. So that's great. And if we care, other people will. Because if nothing else, even if they can't relate to the things that are happening in the story, they'll relate to the emotions that you're feeling. Yeah. So where else can we find stories? Have ideas? Right, first is to just create story files. When something happens, and this works in organizations too, just create a thing, like once a week, everybody put a couple sentences to remind them of a story in a Google Doc or a story file, just something very simple, very clean, right? When something significant happens, right, I have a jar of these things, and I have little colored cards. If I have a significant interaction with someone, even if it's just at the bank or at the grocery store, if I remember, and I'm getting better at this, I'll just write it down because I never know when that could be useful. And for writing prompts sometimes, I've got hundreds of these things at this point, I'll reach my hand into the jar and pick out one and see what it jogs loose, right? So we don't need to flesh these out in real time, just keeping a note of them. The other one is peaks and valleys, as you were just saying, moments of extreme amazing bliss. Moments when we really rocked it, when there was a big win, yay, go team. And then also moments where we blew it, when maybe everything sucks, when we're not sure why we're getting up in the morning anymore. Either of those extremes are really great places to find stories. Moments that you were moved and that resonated. And everybody loves an origin story, right? If you think, again, superhero movies, usually the most interesting part, at least for me, is the origin. That's why they keep showing me Peter Parker getting bit by a spider, right? Every year they remake it, because that's really the only interesting part of that story, right? A high school geek becomes a superhero. So what is, you know, for each of us personally, there's an origin story behind how we got to where we are today. And in that origin, you find that where we are now is totally inevitable, right? So for me, there was a moment that I remembered relatively recently when I was 8 years old, and I confirmed this with my parents, where I looked up from a book of Irish folktales and said, I want to spend my life studying how these stories affect people and where the stories come from. My parents immediately sent me to science camp. They were like, no! But right, so this fascination with story has always been there with me. And if I look at the data points of my life, I can selectively say, oh yeah, there was a definite path to standing here today. So once we've generated raw material, we can look at 6 different story types and see which ones that story might hit. And here they are. We talked about one of them already. A who am I story, what am I doing here, what is my vision, values in action, I know what you're thinking, which we talked about, and a teaching story. These are not necessarily 6 separate stories, right? The story I told this morning about giving the tour at the homeless youth agency told you a bit about who I am, it told you what I'm doing here, and it showed you a little bit about my values in action, right? These are incredibly, particularly if you're in a leadership position or if you're facilitating a group, these are incredibly fast ways that you can build trust. Often, these first 3, the who am I, what am I doing here, and my vision, will all be encapsulated in one story. And as you found, right, our tendency when we're introducing ourselves to doing this is to say, hi, I'm Michael Kass. I work with amazing people and organizations to help them discover and harness the power of their story to create change. I have a graduate degree in theater from Northwestern University. I went, nobody cares. Nobody cares. I don't even care. But if I tell you a story that contains the core values underneath that, suddenly you know me a little bit more, and maybe you'll be more predisposed to share stories with each other.
Yeah.
These are adapted from an amazing book called The Story Factor by Annette Simmons. If you're interested in this stuff, I highly recommend picking it up. It's sort of the seminal work when it comes to organizational storytelling. She's real smart and real easy to read. So once we've generated our raw material, it's time to get to know the audience. Who are they demographically? Who are they politically? The politically thing is important because sometimes I do workshops down in Orange County, and I'll one time in particular, I made a comment about Fox News being unethical in their storytelling, and the room got like 20 degrees colder. And I went, oh, it's not just Fox, it's also everybody, all the news organizations, they all do it, but it was too late. They had ripped me off. A really interesting one that we don't often think about when we think about our target audiences is what do they know or think they know about us and our work, right? It's really important because a lot of times people have a misconception about the work we do in the world or the people we work with or our organizations. And so keying into what that misconception is allows us to craft a story that is an I know what you're thinking story, right? As an example, I just worked with an organization that got some horrible press about 2 years ago, like a total takedown article in the LA Times, and they have not been acknowledging that in their storytelling. So we did this audience discovery exercise, and the first thing that came up is, wow, people really think that we are this horribly unethical organization that does all these bad things. I'm like, well, you gotta meet them where they're at. You have to acknowledge that story, and then you can transform it. But until we acknowledge it, we can't move forward. So doing that part of the exercise for all of the different constituencies or people or audiences that you speak to can be really, really powerful. And then what communities are they a part of? Because you may find that you have communities and passions and curiosities in common. So now we have our raw material, we have our audience, and we can craft a call to action, right? Because remember, we want that oxytocin flowing through the body so that we can inspire people to action. And so when you think of calls to action, what are some examples of calls to action that you might make or that you've received?
Give money.
Give money. That's the, like, yeah. Absolutely. What else? Yeah.
Volunteer.
Absolutely. Come volunteer. Yeah.
Show someone else.
Yeah. Share this, right? Especially if it's on social media. Those are great ones.
Go protest.
Yeah. Go protest. Show up, right? And all of those can be strong. The 3 qualities I always look for in a call to action is it has to be specific. So not just give money, but we need to raise $10,000, $100,000 by this date so that X, right? So that X makes it meaningful. And then I'll say, like, to do that, click here. To share, click here. It has to be immediately actionable. We want people to be able to take action to support us very, very simply. Something that we tend to do as humans is we'll stack calls to action. So it might look like, come volunteer, or contribute, or show up at this protest. That won't, see if you could just limit it to one call to action. The reason for that is that people want to help, they don't want to make decisions. This decision-making is emotional, and so when they're in that oxytocified place, and they're open to taking action, the moment you make them use their brain to make a decision, that effect starts to diminish, and so they become much less likely to take action. So trying to decide for the people you're speaking with, what's the one thing that you can, that you really would love them to do? So now we've got three disparate elements. We've got a bunch of stories, we've got a bunch of audiences, we've got some calls to action. Here's how we put it together. There's a guy named, this comes from Marshall Gantz. Are you familiar with him? So, among other things, he's the architect of Barack Obama's 2008 presidential campaign, the grassroots part of it, which was one of the most effective organizing efforts in the history of such things. It was groundbreaking. And here's the model that he uses. We start with the story of self, which would be a story much like the ones that you all shared in your pairs, right? It's a story that leads you on an emotional journey, that keys you into, if it's not you, it's one, two, at most four people. Science, the research shows us that our brain can hold the emotional journey of up to four people. At five, it all falls apart. Don't know why. So one to four people, taking them on a well-structured journey. At this point, your audience is now emotionally engaged, but maybe they don't know how they fit into it. They don't know what action to take. And so we follow the story of self with the story of us. That's where we go to a more collective vision. What is our vision of success? What is our vision of change? And how can we, as a community, achieve it in the way that I, as an individual, cannot? So now, we're emotionally engaged. We have this collective vision, but we're still not sure what action we should take, and why it's so important that we do it now, which is why the third one is the story of now, right? That's where we impart the sense of urgency and the specific call to action. So, as an example, if I used as the story of self, the story I told you at the beginning of our time together, about getting really curious about story, and like they put the $10,000, and everyone's like, oh, that's, or $20,000, and people are like, oh, that's amazing. Like, and then I got really curious about story, and that's what's led me here. And what I'm really passionate about is helping people build a culture of storytelling in their workplace and in their lives, because I think it will enrich all of us, right? So there's a story of us. I can't do it alone. I need help. And the reason it's urgent, I'm making this up right now, so it might not work right away. But right, the reason it's urgent is that the world has never been more divided. We are seeing each other more and more as avatars of certain points of view or as positions within an organization. And it has never been more important that we come together as human beings, right? So not only is it effective for communication and effective for fundraising and effective for community building, it also, in a small way, saves the world. Please give me $10,000, right? Or whatever. So you see how you go from a very specific story to something that includes all of us. And we've gone from like raising money for homeless youth to saving the world in the space of about 3 minutes. So it doesn't take long. And you can sort of, that wasn't the most amazing example, but you can at least track along with it. So I'm gonna pause there for a moment. About 10 minutes left. We've done a lot in the past hour and 15 minutes or so. Questions or thoughts, challenges coming up that you want to address? Yeah?
Yeah, I'm not exactly sure how to frame this, but I'm just listening to the neurobiology that you talked about. How do you explain the Trump effect?
Oh, yeah.
Because on the one hand, Trump helped people release a lot of cortisol. A lot of stress came around his event, which mobilized people into action. Whereas oxytocin relaxes you. If you have too much oxytocin, then you're like, hey,
So the Trump effect is a little bit complicated because it's not just Trump. It's in, like, within the context of like American history. But we'll just deal with the cortisol part of the question. Fear also motivates people to act.
Right.
It gets exhausted. So as people who want to make a positive change in the world, the other way is to move people from into a emotional place. There's a great book that sort of goes pretty deeply into this called Theory U by, I'll get your email and I'll send it, I can't remember his name, he's German, he works at MIT, but he says that in moments of stress and change, which the world is in right now, there are three ways that we react. The first is what he calls just downloading, where nothing shifts. The other is what you would call the Trump effect, which is to wall off and get very protectionistic, right? And the third is to open up and to go the more oxytocin route and to say, okay, we're gonna come together in a different way. What Trump appealed to, and I would also argue that he did go for the oxytocin release, because here's what he said: people are coming to get you, and I will protect you. All you have to do is vote for me and it's taken care of, because you know me. I'm a very successful businessman. So he actually did do the oxytocin release, but what he used to inspire people to action was the cortisol. And they're still in that fearful place, right? And eventually, it'll get exhausted.
Right. Yeah. But again, I still see more of that, and not even just in his, how he got elected, but just the fears around what it means to have him as a president,
yeah.
And that thought process has mobilized. I mean, we've got more calls from people who want to volunteer.
Totally.
Now than we have in all the campaigns.
Beautiful.
Exaggerating. But it feels as if in terms of this is a time where people are mobilizing to take action in ways that they haven't done since the 60s and 70s and all that kind of stuff. And that is what I mean by the Trump, not just what he
Great. So what happens when they come together to volunteer?
Well, that's the part I know, the oxytocin.
Yeah. So they're creating that story, right? The reason they're being driven to volunteer is it's so uncomfortable in that stressed out place. They need to do something. And the instinct is to come together as a tribe, right? To take action.
Right. But again, in terms of our stories for nonprofits, I get a lot of funders now are saying, we want to hear your success stories.
Uh-huh.
We want to hear how everything went right and, you know, la 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 kind of stuff.
Right.
When that may not be the reality of, you know, most of our clients' experiences, but that's what they want to hear. And I'm thinking that it's, you know, kind of like what you said at one point, was the stories that don't necessarily have a happy ending may mobilize you to take more action.
Totally.
Than to have stories that are wrapped up in a nice little bow and everybody goes away to la la land. So that's kind of what
there's sort of a pernicious relationship that's happened with funders and nonprofits, which is the fund, some consultant told funders they needed stories. Funders went, oh, we need success stories. Nonprofits started feeding them kind of BS success stories.
Exactly.
Because we know that it's messy. So the best thing you could do is redefine success for them and say, here's how we define success. Success is, I'm just using an example from, you know, working with homeless youth. For some of these kids, success is being able to make eye contact and say hello. They're still on the streets, but for them, that's a huge success. And we have enabled that. I found that funders, as long as you explicitly define success, they can be receptive to that, right? Because they don't know the world, right? They don't know the world that we move in. So what preconceptions do they have of the work that we're doing that we can help transform? That's it. But yeah, I hear you. It's a challenge. That's great. Other questions or thoughts? Yeah.
Yeah, I think about the Stephen Colbert effect. You know, I don't know how they screen the audience. I had never heard of Boom. Everybody, you know, seems to be attracted to that building that all this is in. It's all the theater, and people that watch it are getting reinforced, and it's kind of almost an oxytocin type of effect. And this is all over the whole country, and I doubt that his show would be a success at Hillary one. It's just like tremendous energy. So that's a antithesis to.
Well, I think it's the same thing, which is that people are feeling that stress and they're coming together, whether it's by volunteering or watching Colbert. always want to say Colbert, but it's Colbert, right? So yeah, and that is, I don't think they screen, it's a self-selecting audience, right? Who's gonna wait online and do that?
Nicole.
Yeah, Nicole and all of that.
Yeah.
I just had a comment to make off of when you were introducing yourself to us, like kind of mock introducing yourself to us, saying like, oh, I'm so-and-so and I have this degree, and you're like, and I don't want to hear that, I want to hear the story. It made me think, I was like, well, that is your story, but it's also a presentation of facts. Mm-hmm. So like just finding a different way to frame the way you talk about it.
Totally.
I just love,
Yeah, right? There's a difference between a list of data and weaving it together into a story. The list of data isn't going to land in the same way. Yeah?
I just have a, going back to your tour with the funders that ended up being successful, we do this constantly, and I'm thinking, it sounded like a very long tour and lots of stories, but doesn't it get to a place where it's just overkill or it's too much storytelling? Or do you have sort of a formula for, you know, I'm going to spend just a few minutes in this space and then move to another story and make sure to see which one connects? Because I find like sometimes our tours can start and go on for 2 hours.
Yeah.
And by then, I don't know what's happened to them, we've lost them.
Right. So it's 15, that tour I think was like 15 minutes.
Oh.
Generally, you can feel it. If people, right, it goes back to this thing with that we do as organizations a lot of times, which is called floodlighting, where we want, it's so important what we do that we want to tell them all of the things right now. And that is a great way to like watch people glaze over, right? And so what are the right stories to share with them to lead to the right call to action for them at that time? Even if the call to action is, I'd love to just sit down with you for lunch next week. Other questions? It's time for the big finish. Does anybody sing? Me either. So I did want to, you know, we've talked about stories building community. I want to expand to talk for just a minute about story as a way of being in the world. And these are different ways that we can use story, right? Building relationships with contributors, building and maintaining a strong team, the experience that you all had just sharing 2 minute stories with each other, and the sort of empathy that developed. I've done this kind of work a lot within organizations with teams that are somewhat less than optimally functional, and within about an hour, they're communicating with each other in a different way. It doesn't like heal everything, but it does lay the foundation for a new way of interacting, right? That can be very quickly moved into the culture. This kind of work can be used really effectively to diffuse conflict, right? Not by addressing the conflict head on. I'm thinking specifically of a couple times I've worked. The one that's coming up right now is worked with groups of basically warring groups of teachers at a school, and they couldn't even look at each other when we walked in. And I'd been hired to do a workshop like this, and I went like, this is not gonna be useful. So I just had them get into circles and share stories about why they were so passionate about teaching. And within about an hour, suddenly they were able to communicate because they had this shared passion that they keyed into. And the conflict, which had been based on pay scales or something I didn't even get into, kind of started to take care of itself because they were seeing each other as human beings instead of avatars of an opposing point of view, right? It can be used to teach and inspire, to cultivate powerful presence, and also to organically discover core values, right? A lot of times when we're doing core value work within organizations, it's a top-down kind of thing. And look, if you Google core values, you'll find every organization has the same ones. It's usually like trust, we are less outcome-oriented, we really care about process, we have a lot of integrity, we respect each other. Those are great, but unless they're owned, they won't land. And so one really powerful way to discover core values is to do an exercise like the storytelling we did. And as you all found, some of the core values that I heard just in what you were saying is, you know, we look at everything as an opportunity to grow, right? There are no failures would be a core value that came out of one of the stories over here. And those will float up because they're embedded, as you were saying at the beginning, they're embedded within the stories, right? The stories contain the DNA of our values and the DNA of our culture. That has been our epic journey through storytelling this morning. This is my information. Please keep in touch. And if you are interested, I have a downloadable, I can send you this PowerPoint, but then also there's a 40-page book that I created that goes a lot more into detail about all this stuff, outlining the process of building stories. If you would like a copy of that, you can give me your email address and I'll get it to you later today. I also just finished a guide on facilitating story circles, which is kind of like the activity you did in pairs, but in a circle of 5 to 8 people, and it takes you through the process of putting those together. It's a really powerful tool that can be used in all sorts of ways. So if you're interested in that, I'll leave a sheet up here. You can put your email address on it. Thank you so much for your time this morning, friends.